Om Shri Sai Ram.
Sai Ram.
Offering my humble pranams at Bhagwan's lotus feet. Dear Swami, respected elders, dear brothers and sisters. As I said, you know, this talk we'll focus about more on how the organization helps us to achieve what we actually seek to achieve in our life, and hopefully through Bhagwan's words, some misconceptions and wrong ideas and assumptions that we have made will become very clear. And we will also, I feel, we'll arrive at the same conclusion like yesterday, what that love is the most important. So, now there was this disciple who, like all of us, realized what is the sole goal in life. That happiness comes only in union with God. So he went to his guru and he said, "Guru, I want to see God." "Why?" "Because that's the only thing I want in life." The guru said, "Good." He said, "Guru, now tell me from your wisdom, which is the best God?" "What do you mean?" "No, who will become happy very fast and come. हम लोगों को कल युग में सब चीज सबसे बेस्ट चाहिए, सबसे अच्छा माइलेज कार जो सबसे चीप मिलता है, लेदर." So he said, "I want the best God. Who you tell?" Guru said, "I think it is Lord Shiva." भोलेनाथ है, इसलिए राक्षस भी उन्हीं से प्रार्थना करते हैं. He comes and grants their wishes also. So you try Lord Shiva. So he said, "Okay." So he came home and began a detailed ritual worship of Lord Shiva. He had an idol of Lord Shiva. एक लिंगम था, लिंगम पे हाफ बस्ट ऑफ शिवा वाज देयर विद द त्रिशूल एंड डमरू. ही केप्ट दैट आइडल एंड फुल मॉर्निंग टू इवनिंग ही डज ऑल द डिफरेंट क्रिया, कर्म, पूजा, उपासना, अगरबत्ती, कोकोनट, ना एवरीथिंग ही केप्ट डूइंग दिस. वन मंथ पास्ड, नथिंग हैपेंड. सो ही वेंट बैक टू हिज गुरु एंड सेड, "गुरु, ये शिवा काम नहीं करता है." एक महीना ट्राई किया हूँ, फुल सब चीज किया हूँ उसके लिए. So then Guru said, "You do one thing. You try this another thing. You know, what is this? Take this Devi idol, Durga. This time you do bhajans. Bhajans is important. Bhajan karo pura." So he said, "Ah, okay, I'll do." So he brought Devi and full day he spent in bhajans for Devi. Keep doing bhajans. Nothing happened again after 1 month. So again he went back to his guru and said, "Guru, you give me some proven working formula. Yes, sir, nahi ho raha hai. You don't try your experiment on me. Shiva kaam nahi kiya, Devi kaam nahi. You just give me one working formula." So guru says, "See, the supreme consciousness everybody considers is Lord Krishna like that. You meditate on Krishna. You meditate on Krishna, you will achieve the highest. That is what is said." So he brought the idol of Krishna. And now he changed to meditation. He would come, light one lamp, light one agarbatti, and that's it. Meditate. And he was going on. Krishna ka probation period chal raha tha, 15 din hua tha. That is when this Shishya noticed something very unusual. Not unusual actually, but something that he had not observed before. He saw that when he's closing his eyes and meditating, no? That agarbatti smoke is going up and it is going to that Shiva and Devi who are sitting on top there. He said, "Arey yaar, main Krishna ke liye laga raha hoon." And the Shiva is sitting there and taking all the dhoop. Okay? It is not meant for him. Kyunki he is over, his trial period is over. 30 days kuch kiya nahi, kuch diya nahi. So that day he went and brought a piece of cloth. He climbed up and he tied up Shiva's nose. "Bandhya, you don't take my dhoop." The moment he tied Shiva's nose, no, Lord Shiva appeared there with the damaru, with the trishul, with the snake, everything like that. And this guy got scared. He got very scared. He said, "Oh Lord Shiva, forgive me, I'll take it out. Nikal ke tum le, tu pura packet agarbatti le." But Lord Shiva says, "Child, I'm very happy with you. Ask what you want." Said, "Lord, that you leave aside. Now I've got one more question what I want to ask. See, 1 month I did your puja only, yaar. Full time dedicated to you. You didn't come that time. Now I'm neglecting you and I tied your nose. Now, is this the sadhana? Then I'll tell my guru. Tell your shishyas to take an idol and tie its nose." The Lord will appear. All this, he gave me karma mark for you, he gave bhakti mark for Devi, jnana mark for Krishna, nothing is working. Kachit mark is the mark. Lord Shiva says, it's not like that. Today was the first time you felt that I'm alive. For the first time in your life, you felt that I'm a living, breathing entity. The moment you felt that, I became that. Yanta matramana yavvaru talachina anta matrame neenu. Yad bhavam tad bhavati. And that is the basis, whether it is karma, bhakti or jnana. Swami says the basis is prema. Love will make a stone into God. Without love, whatever we do, God becomes a stone. And that is something that we have to keep in mind, whether I am doing seva, whether I am doing bhajan, whether I am doing meditation. Inside me, what's happening is love being born. If anything other than love is being born, what I'm doing is not sadhana. It is disservice to myself. If in the process of doing bhajans, I get irritation and anger and comparison, it is not a sadhana I'm doing. I'm destroying. It is as good as me doing anything else in the world. When I attend a bhajan, when I try to become a singer and I think my way to the Lord is through bhakti, and bhakti is what? Some would say bhakti is intense love for God. Am I getting love? So I feel, irrespective of which wing of the organization we predominantly work, or whether it's a spiritual wing, the service wing or the devotional wing, if there is no love within, it is useless. We can keep worshipping one after another, nothing will happen. And actually we see this Chinnakatha that Swami narrates, you need not even do the rituals prescribed perfectly. Once you get the spirit, the Lord appears. In fact, Swami narrates another Chinnakatha. He said there was this guru who would always do his yajna, and all his shishyas, this was the path that he taught his shishyas. But every time they are preparing for the yajna, there is this cat in the ashram that comes and drinks all the milk and curds. So this guruji, what he did was, he brought a basket, he'll put the cat under the basket, put the basket on the cat, sit on that and do yajna. So that this cat can't cause havoc during the yajna. And this is how it went on. Few years passed, the guru died. Few more years passed, the cat died. Now the shishyas, before doing yajna, they would go to the neighboring village, catch a cat, bring it to this village, put it under the basket and do yajna. If the spirit behind the ritual is gone, it remains a ritual. The spirit behind the ritual makes it spiritual. It is the spirit behind the ritual that is important, more than the ritual itself. Swami has given us beautiful meaning for every ritual. Aarti. You know, when I was reading the history of Aarti, I used to wonder why do we, turn a flame in front of God? There is a historical reason, there is a spiritual reason. The historical reason is available on Wikipedia, the spiritual reason Swami has given. The historical reason is, those were the days when there was no electricity. And people would come to the temple, they can't see God. There are all lamps will be lit everywhere. But still they can't see, because the shadow of the mala will fall on the face, all that will happen. So when everybody is, all are gathered, ready, when they say ready, singing devotional hymn for the Lord, he'll take a flame right from the face till the head. You see the whole idol. Have proper darshan. That is the historical reason. Swami would say the spiritual reason is, every time an aarti is done, you have a prayer in your heart. Lord, let my life be like that camphor piece. Let it be pure and white. Let it be fragrant. Most importantly, may it be used to light up the Lord for others to see. May my life be so that others can use my life to see you. And at the end of it, when they are thrilled and say, who was that amazing person who made this happen? It's not there. The camphor just goes off. Nothing remains. Swami would say, every time you do aarti, this is a prayer you must have. This is the spirit. If the spirit is there, it doesn't matter if the camphor is not there also. But if the spirit is not there, even if you put this big lump of camphor, it's no use. In fact, I remember during the Paduka festival, up the gold plating had just been done, those thin sheets with gum. You should be careful that smoke doesn't go, it'll blacken it, cleaning it is a hell of a job. So that time during Paduka Puja, everybody lit aarti. Swami had to tell them all to put out the aarti. So you see, if we forget the spirit, if we are attached to the ritual, we'll feel, what is the Swami doing? Arey, sab log aarti kar rahe hain, Swami telling to put out the aarti. Because aarti is not about waving a flame to God. Aarti is about making a prayer for leading a life of love and selflessness. Love is the most important. In fact, there is my English teacher from school, his name is Ramohan Rao. Very simple person. In fact, Swami used to call him Mohini. Because Swami said, your devotion is like Radha and like Gopika's your devotion is. Bhakti. Full-time bhakti. He had in fact asked Swami. He asked Swami, Swami, how should we grow in our devotion to you? How should we increase our bhakti? Swami said, there's only one way. What? Express it, Swami said. You express your devotion. In whatever you do, express your devotion. Use your writing to express your devotion for God. Use your cooking to express your devotion for God. Use your accounting to express your devotion for God. That is how your bhakti increases. The other day in Prashanthi Nilayam, I was walking with one gentleman. And another person, he came. You know, this other person is not so much on social media. I am splattered across social media. So he came and said, hey, Sai Ram, Aravind, oh, okay, how are you? This thing? Then he introduced, he said, you know, this is Aravind, yeah, he works in Radio Sai, he is this. And I said, sir, this. Then he himself said, sir, I'm a driver. Oh, okay. And they continued to speak to me. I just smiled and I said, sir, he'll tell driver, sir, he's Padmanabhan, sir, he should drive Swami's car. Oh, Sai Ram. I was wondering, what is it that made poor driver into Sai Ram? Who is this? He's gardener. Okay. When Swami came to International Center, no, all those lawns, everything what Swami that he. Oh, okay, Sai Ram. See, the moment you say I'm a gardener versus I'm a gardener for God makes all the difference. The moment you say I'm a driver versus I'm a driver for God, all the difference. If I'm an accountant, can I be an accountant for God? If I'm a sweeper, can I be a sweeper for God? If I'm an IT professional, can I be an IT professional for God? It changes our perspective so much. Today, what my boss tells me matters. I work very hard, do my best, and he comes and tells me, what is this rot? I'm down in the dumps. And sometimes I don't even do proper work. I ride on somebody else's work. And luckily nothing happens, it becomes a success. And my boss comes and says, well done. I'm happy. I take the raise. I go and treat my family home. That is because I'm working for my boss. I'm working for my company maybe. But when I work for God, I do my best. Whether my boss notices or not. Because boss, you're not my boss. My boss is him. You have got reach only in this organization. He's got reach in the universe. He can employ me anywhere, you kick me out, no problem, I'm going to do this sincerely. If he comes and pats me on my back, my head will not swell. You know, that often happens, when somebody pats our back, our head swells. I don't know what is the nerve connection. But when my boss pats me on the back, I don't feel anything because I didn't do it for this. I'm trying to see, is my Swami smiling, that's all I'm doing for. So when we do everything for God, it changes so much. That is what Swami told Ramon sir, he told him, if you want your bhakti to grow, just express it. Express it. Express devotion. But you know, Raman sir was, like all of us at different stages in our time, in our life, he was saying, Swami, I want to do more sadhana, Swami. Only bhakti means only do bhajan, not tell me, I want to meditate. Swami said, okay, meditate. So Swami, on what should I meditate? You know, there are different things. Today morning, there was meditation on our breath. There is meditation on the flame, jyoti. I know a person, very, very serene, very amazing person, who teaches meditation on your thumb. What do I meditate on? Swami said, Ramyate iti Ramaha. What is Rama? Rama is that which Ramyate. Ramyate means which attracts. So Rama is not one being or anything like that. Anything that attracts you is Rama, is the Lord. Consider that. That is why it is said beauty is divine. Anything that attracts you, consider it as God. Negative things won't come on you. A man will say that woman attracts me, woman will say that man attracts me. The moment you decide that which attracts me is God, see how your feelings change. It changes from lust to devotion. So Swami said, Ramyate iti Ramaha, so meditate on anything that attracts you. He said, Swami, you are the most attractive for me. Swami said, yeah, meditate on me then. So Ramahamsa started this new thing. So he would sit, wherever he is sitting, he'd focus on Swami. And in fact, in the Prashanti Nilayam Bhajanal, near the Krishna Arjuna statue at the back, there are two steps. So he made a permanent place on the step because he felt wherever I sit in the bhajanal, there might be some tall fellow, some fellow who is swinging in devotion. He may block my view of Swami, but if I am on the step here, I can see. So he would sit every day there and keep looking at Swami. Fully meditate, focus, focus, focus. So he kept focusing. One day as he kept his focus, where he kept focusing, he felt that Swami looked at him. He felt happy and he increased his focus. And when he increased his focus, Swami just turned away. And every time Swami looked at him, he'd turn away. So he thought, is Swami actually turning because of me? But then he thought, no, it can't be. It's my ego to think like that. Many times, actually, we don't understand how ego is so subtle, you know. I remember, I used to think that I am being very humble by telling, nahi yaar, Swami mera muh nahi dekhna chahta hai. I am sitting here, see, he'll avoid and go that side, see. And I used to think this is a statement of humility. It's supreme ego. One person said, what, you think you are so important that to avoid you, Swami will change his path? Asap, the person who has written many wonderful fables, he has written one short story about a fly that came and sat on the bull's horn. It sat there and told the bull itself that, hey, if you feel I'm getting heavy, just let me know, okay, I'll fly away. The bull said, I didn't even know when you came. I won't know when you're gone. Don't think you're so. So even when I think that, you know, because I'm sitting here, Swami will avoid and go that side, that's also you. So anyway, yeah. So Ramahamsa was thinking, no, I should not think that because of me, Swami is turning away and all. Right? But it kept happening. Finally, Swami gets up from the chair and walks all the way to the end of the bhajan and comes to him and tells, hey, what are you doing? Swami, I'm seeing you. Swami said, prema to chudali. Swami told him, you must look with love. Don't stare like that. Oh, yes. Even when you meditate, there should be love. If there is no love, that's not meditation. It's a ghur ghur ke dekho mat. These are all my words, but Swami told him this much that Bhagwan tudini prema to chudali. When you look at God, you have to look with love. So whether it is our meditation, whether it is our bhajan, if the result is not love, then it is not the sadhana at all. We are not doing sadhana at all. Because the goal of sadhana is love. Love for God. Okay. So the goal of meditation or jnana, whatever, is love. The goal of bhajan is love. The goal of seva is love. So I'll do seva enough. Hey, bhajan sab kya hai? Log na bhajan log na, actually they are baker. Keep sitting and singing. Don't do this much work also. Feel the people who do seva more. And bhajan people feel, what do they know, yaar? Main ek baar gaata na, 10 log udhar hote hain, unko bhagwan yaad aata hai, yaar. Ye log jaake 10 logon ko khana denge. Kal kaun dega usko khana? Anyway, at least ये थोड़े लोगों को खाना दे रहे हैं। ये study circle लोग हैं ना, ये बैठ के बात गप्पा मारते रहे हैं। क्या? Study circle will feel like, please fellows, keep singing bhajan, keep doing, रहो, do this only. When will they understand? All is life, Swami said, but finally Swami said, I and you are one. I am God and so are you. Of course, I have not reached the level, but at least at intellectual level, I am trying to reach what Swami told. They are just happy singing only, बैठे करते रहो bhajan. This is what happens usually, not only at organization level, at individual level also. So therefore, the question comes, which is the best? Like he said, which is the best God? So Swami, fine, love is the ultimate, but which is the best? Which is the best path? So, you know, in one example that Swami had given, instead of giving the example, let me tell you one little story, one little experience. There was an exhibition that all the students in the school had made for Swami. And as one of the exhibits, one of the students decided to make this example that Swami had given of the three paths, bhakti, karma, jnana. He decided to make an exhibit of that, you know, and show it to Swami. This student is my colleague now in Radio Sai, his name is Sai Prakash. So he made this exhibit. What was the exhibit? The exhibit was one bullock cart, one car, and one aeroplane. That's all. So Swami came and said, Idemi, what is this in exhibition? You're putting vehicles. Said, Swami, these are the pathways to God. No, bullock cart, car, and this. No, Swami, this is karma marga. This is bhakti marga. This is jnana marga. Karma marga is bullock cart. Slowly you will go. You'll reach God. Keep doing seva, 100 lifetimes later you'll reach. Bhakti marga, Swami, this is a little faster, like car it is. Seeing pine, 2-3 janmas, yes, over. But Swami, this is jnana marga, aeroplane. Direct flight. And this is not his own creation. This is the analogy Swami has given. So it's very clear, right? Jnana marga is the fastest and best. Then Swami told him, that is correct. But remember, if you fall from the aeroplane, no, there is no survival. You may go in bullock cart, fall 100 times, nothing will happen. Car, you fall, little injuries. Aeroplane, you fall. You don't fall, you go up actually. Done, finished. So, it is not like there is a best path. Each has its plus and minus. In fact, in another example, Swami says, karma marga is primary school. Bhakti marga is secondary school. Jnana marga is college. Oh, great, yeah. See? Arey Babu, without primary school and secondary school, college will be useless. You won't understand anything. Because in primary school, A is for apple. In college, A means something else. B means something else. It's very amazing. Huh? It's a different language in primary school and in college. ABCD is ABCD in primary school. In college, they mean something else only. So, though bhakti is higher secondary and jnana is college, you can't go to college without primary school. And Swami has given the most perfect example. Actually, in his discourse on the 28th of March 1968 in Venkatagiri, Swami gave this example. I feel it is the most comprehensive answer about which path is most important and most suitable. Swami says, the clock, you see, in the clock, there's a seconds hand. Swami says, the seconds hand, no, is karma marga. The minutes hand is bhakti marga. And the hour hand is jnana marga. Yes, the most important is how much wise we have become. How much we have evolved. That is the most important. Nobody will ask, everybody will ask, is it 9 o'clock or 10 o'clock? Nobody will ask which minute it is. Maybe some people will ask, is it 9:30 or 9:45? But nobody will ask 9:35 which second it is. Nobody bothers with it. But Swami says, if that second hand doesn't move, your minute and hour hand won't move. The second hand has to move one full circle for the minute hand to move one bit. And the minute hand has to move one full circle for the hour hand to move one bit. You have to do so much of good karma to get that good bhava, little bhakti. And so much of bhakti you need to get one insight, to get that wisdom. These are together, you can't separate them. Just like primary school, higher secondary school and college are important. If you say I am ninth pass, useless. You passed ninth standard but didn't do college, useless. Yes, you kept doing karma, you didn't grow in jnana, it is useless. But you can't go to jnana unless you have done karma and bhakti. Nobody bothers about what second it is in the clock, correct? But if those seconds don't run, they have to constantly keep running. Otherwise, the time won't be shown correctly. You know, we think Adi Shankaracharya, okay, I'll come to that later. There was this time, like Ramon sir, as I said, all of us feel, in the hostel I felt I also need to do some more sadhana. What is this? Daily I go, have darshan, do bhajan, come back. That's all. What if you need? Daily I am having darshan, going bhajan. But that's what happens. That is maya. When you stay close to something, till you lose it, you don't realize its value, like that it is. So I was thinking, something I should do. That is when I started reading about Ramana Maharshi, Paramahamsa Yogananda, all others, you know. Read about others and try to follow their path. I mean, all this, I mean, I'm sorry to say, but I feel if we do any of this, it's just, whether we accept it or not, arising from somewhere deep within that, what Swami has given is not enough. I need to know what Aurobindo said. I need to know what. I may justify it in any manner. No, it's only for intellectual curiosity. If my stomach is full with the feast that is kept in front of me, I won't even taste any other food. Nahi yaar, abhi nahi, bas ho gaya. But somehow I feel, no, maybe there is some easier way than Swami. My faith is not complete, whether I accept it or not. Most of the times, our faith is only emotion. It's only emotion. I'll stand here and shed 2 tears. That's emotion. In the Ramakatha Rasavahini, Swami writes that Rama tells Sugriva, you go challenge your brother. Wali, I'll take care, don't worry. Sugriva says, Rama, you're awesome, you know, I can see your girl muscles. I know you're strong and all, but Wali, no, don't underestimate him, Rama, you know, he's very strong. And Rama has to prove to Sugriva. He'll shoot a bow, he'll shoot an arrow through with his bow through those 7 trees. Then that demon that Wali has killed, actually that's what happens first. There's a Dundubi or somebody. The carcass, the dead body of that Rakshasa is lying there. And Sugriva says, you know, when he killed him, when Wali killed him, he threw him from that mountain to this mountain. Rama goes and just kicks it like it. It flies 7 mountains that way. Sugriva first says, wow, yaar. Hey, but no, this is a 20-day-old body. Full, it is rotting and weight would have reduced off. When Wali threw it, was full heavy body. So that's why Rama has to do multiple tests. Then he feels, okay, Rama, I think yes, I'll go and challenge. And in the Ramakatha Rasavahini, Swami writes how Sugriva goes and challenges Wali and gets thrashed. He gets cracked, beaten black and blue and comes back. And as he comes back, no, he starts telling, hey Rama, what? Rama, what is this? Simply you told, I went and I, this is my own emotion. Swami writes very decently only. But Sugriva comes and tells, Rama, what? I trusted you. This is what you did. He smashed me. I told you, teri hath ki baat nahi hai. Left, I was peaceful here. No, why? I don't want that kingdom. Fine. He has kept my wife. Let him keep fine. I am here. Why? Simply you told now, see, I got smashed. He's going on and on and on and on and on. As he's going on and on, no? This Swami writes, Rama walks towards Sugriva and gently massages his back. In that instant, all his wounds are healed. He's so full. He's complete. No pain. Everything gone. Suddenly he's, oh, Rama. Why do I need that kingdom, Rama? You are there with me, I don't want anything else. You are the supreme, oh Rama. Nothing is there beyond you. Rama tells him, shut up. This is emotion. This is not devotion. 5 minutes back, you're thrashing. When things go good, you'll praise me. When things go bad, you thrash me. This is just your emotion. When we get an experience, Swami is really Swami. Swami is only. When things go bad, hey Bhagwan, tune kya kar diya? Maine kya kiya? Kuch nahi kiya. Swami, why are you not taking me to Delhi? Hare, I'm taking you. I'll let you know at the correct time. If I have 100% faith in Swami, I will never question anything in life. I will always celebrate whatever happens in life. Because my Swami is the most powerful, my Swami is the most loving. So it is not as if something happened and he couldn't stop it. He can stop it. He has the power. And it's not as if something bad is happening and Swami is telling, one day, I don't like this fellow, isko one day. Khunna se mere ko iske upar. It's not like that. God loves me also more. So when he loves me the most, when he is most powerful, yet if something is happening, it must be happening because it is good for me. My 2-year-old daughter Bhakti, every now and then I had to go to the doctor for her vaccination shots. It was easy when she was just 3 months, 4 months old. Because she doesn't know anything, you know. I take her and I just get the shot, she'll howl, they'll pull out the needle, and she's forgotten it, over. Terrible crying for 15 seconds, 45 seconds. First few times it was just 15, 20 seconds. You pull out the needle, the tear stops. Push the needle, she'll cry. Pull it out, it stops, like that it is. But now it's a ritual. There's a 45 minute scheduled crying. 20 minutes as we start telling on you. It'll go to next notch when she sees the doctor. was thinking it will be maximum when the doctor pokes the needle. It is not maximum that time. It is maximum after he pulls out the needle. Why? Because physical hurt is over. But that psychological hurt she has. Dad, I trusted you, Dad. I thought you will protect me. I jumped into your arms and what you did? You took me to that same butcher, that same Rakshasa to poke it even more. Instead of stopping and holding his hand, you held my hand. And she cries. Why? Because in 2 years she has become little more intelligent. This is what happens when we become little intelligent. I just felt this is how God must be feeling. Now what do I tell my daughter? I tell her, Bhakti, this is for your good. What good? It's paining so much. How it can be for my good? Oh yeah, you wait. You grow up, become an adult. When you become an adult, no? And when everybody is getting typhoid, you don't get typhoid, no? You tell me, Dad, thank you. I feel when we cry out and tell God, what did you do? How can this be good for me? God will be telling you, grow up, become like me. When you become like me, you will see that what I did is good for you. And because I love my daughter, no, even if she cries, I'll take her again and get her poked. I don't care what she thinks of me. If she thinks I'm a terrible man, let her think. But I will do for her good. That's how God thinks for us. You think of me, or you misunderstand me, leave me and go, no problem. But I love you. I will do what is good for you, whether you like it or not. If you protest and pray and tell, I don't want this, no, I can't. Because I really love you. And if you are able to grow intelligent enough to understand this and bear with it, I'll be grateful to you, my child. I feel that is what Swami is telling us. Anyway, I digressed a bit. Coming back, so I was thinking that I should do some sadhana, start reading all other masters, everything. And I read about how Ramana Maharshi, he would lie down and think like, if I'm a dead body, then my breath is gone and all that, I got very inspired. I'll also do this. So every night I'll go and sleep in the prayer hall. We were allowed. If you want, we can sleep in the prayer hall too. At night I'll close and tell, okay, I'm not this body. If I'm not the body, why do I need breath? I'll hold up the breath. I don't need my breath, no, because I'm not the body. But somehow, how much ever I tell myself intellectually I'm not the body and all, after some time the breath comes around and I start breathing. But anyway, I was doing this for quite some time. Now that year, during Dasara, a very strange coincidence happened, wherein Swami started his poem by saying, man doesn't know what is sadhana. Swami said, without sleeping at night, holding his breath, he thinks this is sadhana. The amazing thing is, today when I go and see, it was actually a wrong hearing on the part of the translator and ourselves. Swami had said something else. Swami had said, without doing any work, he will sleep and think it is sadhana. But for that day, strange reason, it was translated as, without sleeping at night, holding his breath, he thinks it is sadhana. That's why I say there's nothing like a mistake in Swami's presence. It hit me. I felt like Swami directly telling me, hey, without sleeping at night, you're holding breath and thinking that's sadhana. Anyway, so that day when he said that, the next question was, so what is sadhana, Swami? And Swami's next statement was, I will tell you what is sadhana. I said, wow, tell me. Swami said, there's only one sadhana. See God in everyone. See Sai in all. Hey, Swami will, he's an amazing marketing agent. He'll tell it off. Simple, it is. Just see Swami in all. Oh, tough it is, yeah. I can see Swami possibly in my parents. But people who irritate me, who hurt me, I don't know how to see Swami in them. In fact, as I said, many times we don't see Swami in Swami himself. We think Swami is a man. That is the way we behave. That is the way we treat him. It is so tough to see Swami in Swami. How do I see Swami in everyone? But, on deeper thought, if I want to see Sai in all, as again it was said in the morning, what is Sai? S, service. A, adoration. I, illumination. Service, seva. Adoration, bhakti. Illumination, jnana. We can't hold on to one and say that other two I don't need. They're all intertwined. Like our DNA is intertwined with two strands. Our spiritual progress is intertwined with three strands. You pull out any one of it, it's not spiritual progress at all. In fact, Swami gives another analogy. So many analogies Swami has given. He says your life is like a auto rickshaw, a tricycle, trichakra vahana. And Swami says, those three wheels, what are they? He says, they are karma, bhakti and jnana. You choose which one you want as your front wheel. You may say, I am bhajan singer, Swami, bhakti is front wheel. Okay. But you need to have your back two wheels of jnana and karma. Otherwise, your auto rickshaw will collapse. It won't go ahead. You can keep service as your front wheel if you want. But don't degrade bhajan and study circle. There are the other two wheels you need. That is what I was saying in the beginning, you know, of Adi Shankaracharya. Anybody will tell Adi Shankaracharya is a great jnani. Which marga? Jnana marga. Mudakaratam odakam sadavi mukti sadakam. This is Adi Shankaracharya's composition. He has given the greatest number of shatakams, ashtakams and all this. What was a jnani doing composing all these shlokas and things? Setting up, establishing temples. Why? When he says everything is divine, he didn't sit at one place. And you know what? Adi Shankaracharya lived for an age of 32 years. In 32 years, he has walked north and south, east and west two times. Walked, because there was no flight, no Indigo, no Jet Airways. He walked. How much karma he has done, my God. Walking. So though we say he is a jnani and jnanamargi, the amount of bhakti and karma that he has embodied is tremendous, because he knows that life is an auto rickshaw. One wheel can't take you. You need all the three wheels. And this is Swami's example. That is why it becomes so important that we don't neglect the other because of one. And that is also, conversely, you know, it also works as a way to test our own hypothesis, whether I am growing spiritually. If I am on the Jnana Marga, if my bhakti is not growing, then it is not Jnana Marga at all. If I am on the Jnana Marga and I don't feel like doing Seva, I am not on the Jnana Marga at all. If I am doing Seva and my love for others is not growing, I am not doing Seva at all. It's all linked. In fact, this 9-point code of conduct, very grateful that it was brought up. I brought a printout of that 9-point code of conduct, okay. Why I brought this is, okay, agreed. I need bhakti, karma, jnana. All three I need. My mind, you know, what are the next question I asked? Okay, how much of bhakti, how much of karma, how much of jnana? Yeah, I need all three. So I will sing one bhajan and then go and do my seva. Done, no? I've done bhakti. I've sang one bhajan. No, you should sing five. How do I know how many bhajans I should sing? How do I know? Once in a year I go and do that Prashanti Seva. Done, I'm doing Seva. Rest of the time I sit and read Swami's discourse. So, after I agree that, we are agreed, right? We need all the three. I mean, Swami has only said, we need karma, bhakti, jnana. So my next question that I got was, how much of bhakti, how much of karma, how much of jnana? And literally like the Da Vinci Code, I don't know if you watched that movie. I assume most of us would have watched, because it's a beautiful movie. Like how the thrill he got in cracking the Da Vinci Code, I got like that thrill with the 9-point code, you know. Because, let's do that, you know, let's do the exercise that I did. The first point says daily prayer and meditation. So what does that come under? Bhakti, karma, jnana. Daily prayer, bhakti. Bhakti. Yes. Bhakti. So that is one bhakti. Second point is devotional singing with family members once per week.
Bhakti.
Bhakti. So two for bhakti. Participation in Sai spiritual education by children.
Jnana.
Just sit in Sai spiritual education. Okay, so two bhakti, one jnana. Participation in community service and other programs of the organization.
Karma.
Two bhakti, one jnana, one karma. Regular attendance at devotional meetings of the organization. Easy. Bhakti, devotional meeting, I mean, devotion is bhakti. So now three bhakti, one jnana, one karma. Regular study of Sathya Sai literature.
Jnana.
So three bhakti, two jnana, only one karma. And like A.B. de Villiers or Virat Kohli smashing the slog overs, now see how karma's batting goes. Use of soft, loving speech with everyone.
Karma.
Avoidance of talking ill of others in their absence.
Karma.
Practicing stealing on desires with money, this karma. Thak, thak, thak. From 2 to 1, it became 2, 3, 4. I felt, Wow, Swami has also given the proportion in the 9-point code of conduct. 2 jnana, 3 bhakti, 4 karma. Makes sense. You need to do lot more karma than bhakti. Lot more bhakti than jnana. Because it is karma and bhakti that give value to jnana. Otherwise, jnana is hollow, superficial knowledge which won't help us at the time of need. I am not the body, I am the atma. If I come and tell this when your mother dies or your child dies, you will slap me. Because it's only superficial knowledge. So therefore, I feel this 9-point code of conduct is simply amazing. When God gives, it's like an onion, you know, multiple peels, multiple layers will be there. On the face of it, it looks like 9 instructions. But it's got everything embedded in it. Once when Swami had asked Swami, what should the students do more to please you? Swami said, they need not do anything. Let them just follow the hostel schedule, that's enough. That's all, Swami. That's all, right? I didn't get up for Subratam today. Anyway, but the thing is, when God gives, it looks very easy because that's how He markets it. It's easy, you can do it, don't worry. But as we spend time with it, as we study it, we'll start seeing how it reveals multiple layers. And this for me was like a revelation. Wow, how much of bhakti, how much of jnana, how much of karma is embedded there? Ratio 2, 3, 4. 2 plus 3 plus 4 is 9. In the 9-point code of conduct. Because as I started classifying also, I thought, oh, okay, the Seva, we should change the name of the Sathya organization. Because there's no Seva, no karma coming in this 9-point code of conduct. But as I said, in the last 3, like slog over, tuck, 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 3 karma comes up. So therefore, we need all the 3 and the proportion also there. If I feel that in a year I'm spending, if in a month I'm spending 90 hours for my spiritual progress, in a month, in the 90 hours, yes, 20 hours ready to be for study of satsang literature, listening to discourses, listening to satsang, such things. Let me spend 30 hours in bhakti, listening to glories of God, reading the Bhagavatam, attending bhajans. Let me spend 40 hours in karma. Because that is how it appears to me. This proportion is not what Swami has directly said, but this is what I derived and I felt really excited. That's why I'm sharing it with all. It shows that we need all the 3 and also gives an approximate proportion, not approximate, exact proportion in which we need it also. Again, coming back to what we began with, all this is fine, but all that has to be with love. Love is the most important. You know, Swami would give an example of how a person started writing God's name, Namaskaran, Om Shri Sai Ram, whatever. After some time, his guru had told him, do this 1008 times every day. So he said, 1008 times hand pains take so much time. So next time onwards, no, he would keep a carbon paper and he would write. So now only 504 times he has to. Why not use 2 carbon papers? Why not do Xerox? You do Xerox. Swami said, then the punyam you won't get, man. The Xerox machine will get. We get those things, device for 150 rupees. Put it, Om Bhur Bhuvasvaha. You keep going on and on and on. And we think we are doing Namasmarana. That machine is doing Namasmarana. It will get liberated. I am not chanting even one guy. Because it's the spirit that matters, it's that love. Let me do it even once. There's that story of Priyatam, who is the most dear to the Lord. And Narada is told that some farmer is dear and he wonders how. Because I am doing 24 hours Namasmarana. That farmer does only thrice in the day. And Lord Narayana tells him, carry this. Till the brim there is oil, carry it on your head. If you drop 1 mile, I'll chop your head. 1 drop if you drop. And when he comes back, he says, nah, now tell me how many times you chanted. Where I chant Narayana, I was going on thinking of my head. Like that. When a person is in samsara, no, when he's doing, he's balancing so many times, that time he's able to think. So it's about the love. That is the beautiful thing about God. Because he sees the effort, that's all. That is the difference between God and man. Man, how he judges us? How much you got? 80%. How much you got? 90%. Wow, good. You are bad. Improved. But with my own eyes, I have seen where Swami comes to the portico and he says, kitna aya? Swami, 92%. You know, you should see also the way it is told. Swami, 92%. You know, great pride. Improve, kar. 95, improve, kar. Better. Then Swami says, you how much? And we all feel, oh God, Swami, you picked the wrong day. If you're not happy with 92, this guy is going to break your heart. So he gets up. Haan, kitna? Swami Singh. He also doesn't want Swami to know how much he got. Bolo. Swami Singh. Hey, tell properly. 65. Very good. Hey Swami, wait. This is not rank, this is marks. 92 is better than 65. Very good. And then Swami says, Raat ko pura pada hai kya, janta hoon. Swami janta hai. Better. Possibly this is a 60% boy. He has slogged and put in extra effort from 60, he has come to 65. This is a 95 boy. He has taken it easy and come to 92. God is not happy with your results. God is happy with your efforts. God's eyes. Because all of us may not be capable of the same result, but all of us are capable of the same effort. All of us are capable of putting 100%. Here one little disclaimer, because last time in one place I had spoken this, and it came in the context of bhajan singing. I said, haan yaar, Bhagwan to bhava priya hai. So I will also sing. Main bhi full bhakti se gaa raha. Why are you not allowing me to sing? नहीं भगवान भाव प्रिय है लेकिन हम लोग भाव प्रिय नहीं है हम लोग सब बाह्य प्रिय है सो इफ यू वांट टू सिंग फॉर योर भगवान व्हाई आर यू फाइटिंग फॉर चांस इन द सेंटर सिंग इन योर बाथरूम द लॉर्ड विल हियर इफ यू वांट टू सिंग इन द सेंटर प्लीज इट्स नीडेड बिकॉज इट्स नॉट जस्ट भगवान हु इज लिसनिंग इट इज भगवान एंड एवरीवन हु इज लिसनिंग एंड एवरीवन इज इन माया दे कैन नॉट सी ओनली भाव दे सी रागा तारा आल्सो दैट इज द थिंग So, while for the bhajan coordinators, I feel we should keep in mind that we should see the bhava of the people. For aspiring singers, we should also remember that bhava is enough for God. But even Swami insisted on strict quality control when it came to singing in the mandir. I have got a chance to sing for Swami without mic face to face. Swami, how much he loves me, I know. But he never put a mic in front of me and told sing. Never. Because you have to work on that. Because the world judges you by your result. I will judge you by the effort. So you want to sing, I will give you a chance to sing. Don't worry. I will appear to you in your house, in your bathroom, I will come. If your objective is to please me. But how many times is that our objective? Mostly our objective is to get words from people saying, what a great sevak I am, what a great singer I am, what a great speaker I am. I come here just, Sathya Sai organization is another avenue for me to grow my ego, that's all. The professional life is one avenue, my hobbies is one avenue, later Sathya Sai organization also is another avenue. I use it to grow my ego when the objective is to demolish that actually. And that is why all these things come. मुझे चांस नहीं मिला गाने का मुझे ये नहीं मिला वो सिर्फ हमें वो कुछ काम नहीं करता है लेकिन उसी को कोऑर्डिनेटर बनाता है मैं इतना काम करता हूँ कोई नहीं देखता है अरे इफ वी कैन स्टॉप एंड गो बैक टू व्हाई आई एम डूइंग व्हाट आई एम डूइंग दिस आई एम डूइंग टू प्लीज स्वामी नो इफ स्वामी इज हैप्पी डजंट मैटर व्हाट अदर्स थिंक ही इज द डायरेक्टर यार दिस मूवी आई माइट बी द बेगर नेक्स्ट इफ डायरेक्टर इज हैप्पी ही विल गिव मी द रोल ऑफ द हीरो इन द नेक्स्ट मूवी आई नीड टू जस्ट डू माय रोल परफेक्टली If my role is that of a beggar, I can't have, I know how to act like a king. No, yeah, but your role is beggar now. Act as a beggar only. So I feel so important is that we do this for God. And when we say we are doing it for God, it's not about the results we are producing. It's about the effort we are putting in. It's about the effort we are putting in. Now we have a goal, 93 families for 93rd birthday. I may put all my heart and soul, I will not achieve 93. Chima sir may say that, no, no, you should have done better. But if I have sincerely put all my effort, I know Swami will be happy. I may be lucky that not 93, 180 families may come. And Chima sir may say, you did an awesome job. But I know actually I didn't do anything. Chima sir may be happy, but Swami knows the truth. Swami knows that I could have brought 300 if needed. So it's not about... That's why it is said this is not a hierarchical organization. There's only one hierarchy, all of us and Swami. He has to be pleased, that's all. Others doesn't matter if they are pleased or not, as long as I am pleasing Swami. And it's a tougher thing, no, to please Swami. Because Swami knows the truth, that is the thing. We can't hoodwink him, we can't cheat him, we can't fudge numbers and tell him that we did it. Because Swami straight away strips us, we stand bare in front of him. We are stripped, we have nothing, he knows everything. On another thought, that is the reason why he is God. You know, I feel, Swami, you know everything about me and yet you love me. Let us think of people who love us. If they get to know our one or two weaknesses, they'll leave us and go. Finally, you know, in conclusion, this is one story that I always love to say. Many people might have already read it or know it, but I still love to say it because it gives us an ideal about how we should be. This is the story of a person called Krishna Dasa. This Krishna Dasa used to visit the village temple, and in that village temple he would sit whole day. There was a speciality about this temple. What was the speciality? This temple was the place where every day Lord Krishna would appear before the priest. He will appear. And the priest will have a full list. Lord, that Jagannath said that his daughter's marriage is not having more to do. You tell him, Kucho, wait. Ramu has that crops problem. Okay. So everybody will send him. So some will be answered. For some, he will tell yes. Some he will tell not now. Never he'll say no. Because as Swami says, Sai ki sarva, Swami will always say yes. Even if he says no, it is just a delay. Because he wants to give it at a correct time, that's all. Yeah, I'm tempted, please, one little detour. When I say of God's timing, you know, I had written a letter to Swami in Vrindavan. And what was it that I had written in that letter? For the previous 1 week, every day Swami had taken a letter from me. So I had run out of prayers to make. I didn't know what else to write. You know, every day, 7 days he has taken a letter. So, but still I want to write a letter. So I said, why I want to write a letter now? I want to write a letter because, you know, when Swami takes a letter from me, I feel very happy. Ah, nice. Dear Swami, I have nothing to write, but I get great joy when you take a letter from me. For experiencing the joy that I get when you take the letter from me, I am writing this letter. With love, sorry. And I was so sure that Swami will take this letter from me. Because till now I made all selfish worldly prayers and all that he has taken. This is such a selfless, beautiful prayer. I am doing this only for joy, nothing else. And that day Swami came, he came close to me, didn't take my letter, walked on. I felt, Swami, at least you should not have come close to me. I thought, okay, he didn't come, so. But you have come close to me and still not taken my letter. Anyway, no problem. And Swami was walking, suddenly we saw one car came out. And we got to know that Swami is going to the General Hospital in Bangalore because it was the 25th anniversary celebrations. Oh, okay, Swami is in a hurry, that's why. And I saw Swami didn't take many letters on him. He kept walking fast. One or two he took and that also he is giving to the person behind to keep in the cover. Said, oh, okay. Chalo, maaf Swami. Because you are in a hurry today, you have to go to General Hospital. So in Vrindavan, if you have seen, it's like this only. The seating, ladies on the side, gents, center path. Swami had walked down the center path. I was seated in the first block along the center path. Swami walked down the center path, turned around, walked down the gents side. And when he reached one corner there, suddenly he turned and looked at me. He was about 12 meters away from me. He walks down those 12 meters and tells, give me a letter. Take that letter. And I am in cloud 9, you know, 7th heaven. I am so happy. And Swami climbs up the stage, sitting with the letter in his hand. And after that, Bhajan Swami says, do Aarti. He gets up, walks to the car with the letter in the hand, sits in the car with the letter in hand and goes. And I am so happy. And then it hits me, what I had written in the letter. Swami, I am writing this letter for the joy that I get when you take the letter from me. Had he taken the letter from me the way I had planned it, I would have got joy, no doubt. But it would be nothing comparable to the joy I got now. When I knew that he walked all the way just to pick my letter. We always feel that God doesn't answer me. God is wanting to answer me. He will answer me at the right minute. We think God comes at the last minute. No, he comes at the right minute. That is the minute when it makes impact. But till then, can I hold on? Do I have the patience to hold on? Prahlada was, you know, put into snakes, under elephant, in the ocean, in the fire, all that. There's one poet who has written a beautiful thing. He says that Prahlada was thrown from the cliff. And we know that Lord Vishnu was there to catch him. But that poet writes that Vishnu did not catch him like this. Vishnu caught him like this. And why? Because he says, imagine we are thrown from the hill. Sai Ram. No problem. Sai Ram, Sai Ram, Sai Ram, Sai Ram, Sai Ram, Sai Ram, Sai Ram. That's what happens. When problem comes in our life, no problem. Swami is there. 2 days the problem doesn't go, Swami, what's happening? 3 days, Swami. That's what. The Lord wanted to show the world that look at Prahlada. I won't catch him here. I'll catch him here. 1 inch away from the ground. He's still Om Namo Narayanaya. Still same calm. Because he knows the Lord can catch me 1 millimeter off the ground and put me back on top. That is faith. So coming back to this concluding story. So Krishna Dasa is there and this priest sees that every day Krishna Dasa sits in the temple and he's crying. Crying, crying, crying. His heart melts for Krishna Dasa. Yaar, what is bothering him, yaar? But his Krishna Dasa never tells him. So one day, the priest is very upset with Krishna. So when Krishna comes, there is no welcome, there is no food, nothing. So Krishna says, what happened? Where's my food and my asana and all? He says, Krishna, something has been bothering me. What is bothering you so much that you have not made my offering? What is it? He says, Lord, you see that Krishna Dasa? Yeah, yeah, I see him. You see, he's crying like that for you, Lord. Go and respond to him, no. Another mistake that we make. Bhagavan, please take care of Arnu. Please cure Arnu. Please do this for him. I mean, we feel that, God, I think you forgot this person. Let me pray. No, if I'm genuinely praying out of love, that's okay. But many times we pray because we feel that we know better than God. God, please, I should get this visa. I should get this rank. Hey, Arvind, what are you doing about Iraq? What about Iraq? You know, Iraq is such a problem. Oh no, God will take care. God can take care of Iraq problem, but my problem, no, God, listen to me, I know, I'll tell you. See, because you know, you are good for the world, but for my life, I think I know better. This is my attitude with God, actually. So the priest says, God, my heart has melted, your heart has not melted. So Krishna tells, oh, okay. Ask him and come now what he wants. No, Krishna, I will not do that. Why I should ask? You yourself say you don't like intermediaries. Direct connection, no? You only ask him. No, I didn't tell you to ask him what. I'm telling you to ask him whether he wants me to grant what he wants. Lord, what is this question? Definitely, no, otherwise he's a day and night and cry there. He wanted to grant only. Go grant it to him. No, you just ask him. If he tells yes, I'll grant it off. Tomorrow itself, okay? Okay. So Krishna goes. So the priest comes, very happy. Boy. Yes. Today Krishna came. He was speaking about you. Aha. Krishna asked whether he should fulfill what is in your heart. I'll tell him yes, no? No. What? If it is his wish to fulfill, let him fulfill. The wish is what is his wish. Hare yaar. The priest goes back and Krishna comes and says, what happened? Yeah, Krishna, go and grant it. No, what did he tell? I'm telling you, no, Krishna, you grant it to him. No, you tell me what he said. Krishna, he said that, I don't know, Krishna, what is this football? He's kicking you, you are kicking there. He's telling that if you want, you grant it. And Krishna immediately says, I knew it. And he starts dancing. I knew it. Priest says, Krishna, why are you feeling so happy? He says, this is how the feeling is, priest. I'm very happy. Why? You still didn't understand. You are my priest and you are not able to understand. No, Krishna, I am not able to understand anything. Okay, listen. When you have problems, whom do you come to? You, O Krishna. Why you come to me? Because Krishna, you are the ultimate solace. You will solve all my problems, you will take care of me. Not only me, my whole village. That's why we all turn to you only. You turn to me only when you have got problems, no? Other times? Yeah, Krishna, sometimes we get lost in the world, we forget about you. But, you are Karuna Sindhu, Daya Sagara. You are the ocean of compassion, you are the ocean of mercy. How many times we do this? You still love us. it reminds me in one discourse I'm just saying, how do you go and ask your father for any gift? You go and tell dad, I want this pen, give it to me. Do you go and tell, oh, the one who wears the beautiful suit, the one who drives a magnificent car? You don't tell all that, no? Then why you come to me and say, hey, Daya Sagara, hey, don't butter me, come to the point, you know? Because God should be so close, he's closer to you than your father. Anyway, so this priest tells that, you are the ocean of compassion, you are the Lord of mercy, you know, but so even if we forget you, we know that you are there for us. Why you think like that? Because Krishna, you are an epitome of selfless love. Whether we come to you or not, no, you are there for us. See, priest, you are happy in your life because you have me, no? You can be happy only when you experience selfless love. I do have that need, oh priest. I do need that. You feel that whenever you have a problem, you can come to me. I feel that whenever I have a problem, I can go to Krishna Dasa. You feel that rest of the time you don't think of me, you still I will respond to you. I know that rest of the time I don't think of him, he will still respond to me. I am your support. He is my support. If I tear your heart, there is Krishna there. If you tear my heart, there is Krishna Dasa here. There is nothing grand or glorious about saying that I depend on Swami. Swami is my everything. Because that is true for a lizard, for a bird, for a kite, for a crow. They depend on God and God is everything for them. Being given a human birth, can I lead my life in such a manner that Swami can say that I depend on Him? I know that whatever I do, He will not let go of me. Can we become Sai Dasa? I would just like to conclude with a prayer that we become like that. Thank you. Jai Sai Ram.